Hello and welcome to Big Picture. I am Vishal Dahiya and today we will talk about the developmental projects in the northeastern region. 16 years after the commencement of work, the Bogibeel bridge over the river Brahmaputra was finally inaugurated by Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Tuesday. With a length of 4.94 kilometer, this is now the longest rail-cum-road bridge in India and comes as a big breather for the people of Northeast. With this bridge becoming operational, distance from Dibrugarh to Rangiya will be reduced by 170 kilometer and a train journey from Itangar, that is the capital of Arunachal Pradesh, to Dibrugarh will be only 180 kilometer. People from Dhemaji, Jonai and North Lakhimpur who had to earlier travel a whole day to cross the river Brahmaputra to reach Dibrugarh will now cross the river within minutes. Now, the centre government has given a big push to a diverse range of infrastructure projects in the northeastern region in the last 4 years. The emphasis has been on improving rail, road, air and inland waterways connectivity in the region. And in addition to this, schemes such as National Bamboo Mission, Digital Northeast Vision 2022 and Northeast Industrial Developmental Scheme have also been launched for overall development of the northeastern states. For more on this, we are joined by a distinguished panel of guests today. Let me start by introducing them. We have with us Mr. Balmiki Prasad Singh, a former governor of the state of Sikkim. We also have with us Himanshu Watts, a senior editor, Economic Times. And we are joined by Mr. Deepak Dewan, the editor of Northeast Sun. We also have with us the former secretary of Ministry of Urban Development, Mr. Shankar Agarwal. Welcome all of you gentlemen to Rajya Sabha TV studios. Let me begin with you, Mr. Dewan, to try and understand the importance of this particular bridge, because this is what the peg to discussion on today is about the Northeast developmental project is. This is considered to be the longest rail-cum-road bridge. That apart, the significance specifically, it is being said that this will give relief to both the people in the state of Assam as well as Arunachal Pradesh and neighboring other states as well.
And also, by cutting down the travel distance, the country, means the people, those who are using the transport from longer route will save 10 lakhs a day worth fuel. By cutting short this distance by using this bridge. And the bridge connects people. That should be the most important thing. Like Arunachal has been always the farthest state in the country. To bring them closer through bridges, through connectivity, and nothing else should be done. I mean, you know, these are the projects which would bring people closer to, you know, the mainland.
Okay.
And Prime Minister has said many times in the Northeast, because what is important for Northeast, I remember always, he said Northeast needs three C's: connectivity, communication and commerce. Mm-hmm. See, the commerce comes with the connectivity. So the bridge would also improve the, you know.
Okay. So it all starts with connectivity. Let me bring in Mr. Balmiki Prasad Singh here. You've been the governor of one of the northeastern states as well. And, you know, it has been talked about for decades now that this entire region, those all eight states, need a specific push when it comes to infrastructure projects, the developmental projects. And as Deepak was pointing out, Prime Minister's words, three C's. So is that the focus area?
I must tell you first that I am extremely happy today. In the year 1966, more than 50 years ago, I became the subdivisional officer of North Lakhimpur. And my district was in Dibrugarh. So first time I had to cross. So I went with my wife, the jeep was put on the mar boat, and we took more than half the day just to cross over the river. But of course, as the district officer from Dhemaji, you can fry fish. The fish was flowing and your staff will always help you have some nice fish. Mm-hmm. That's a part. You know, I had come from a place called in Bihar, that is Baroni, Begusarai. And just a few years earlier, a bridge was in 1959 opened over Ganga. When I crossed that, I then realized that it is so difficult, that Ganga Bridge is nothing. So I had that vision that one day, because you know Lakhimpur had Dhemaji also as a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So now these are both two independent districts. The second thing that happened was that there is one Mr. D. Ehring. He was in the Council of Ministers of Srimati Indira Gandhi. Mm-hmm. He was to select capital for the Itanagar, assisted by Raja. So he came to my house and it was raining. I had known Itanagar.
Okay.
It was a village. So we went to Harmati Tea Estate of Lakhimpur, and from the top of it, we said, this is the place. And that is how Itanagar was selected, because mm-hmm. I had visited that village earlier.
So there is a very urgent need for the infrastructure projects.
I must tell you that the biggest challenge facing the Northeast mm-hmm. is connectivity. And this bill, particularly this Bogibeel bridge, gives me a lot of happiness. The earlier bridge was also inaugurated about a decade ago, that linked Tejpur with Naugaon. I was then moved to Tejpur as deputy commissioner.
Mm-hmm.
And this was all happening 4, 5, 6 years after the Chinese aggression.
Mm-hmm.
Now, then we had a fear that with superior military power, the Chinese may use our bridges to keep us under control. That is the geopolitical significance of this development.
Okay.
But today that fear is not there.
Mm-hmm.
Our geopolitical situation is much, much better than what it was before.
And this entire push on the infrastructure is also part of the Act East policy as well. Let me bring in Mr. Watts here. Mr. Watts, if you look at Mr. B.P. Singh has pointed out, and the Prime Minister's 3C focus as well, the connectivity is seemingly the key focus area here. But apart from that, the commerce as well as communication, these other two are also supposedly being given push by the government.
Yeah, see, commerce is and overall industrial activity, that's a very important part of life. And if you look at the Northeast, I think this region used to be way ahead of the rest of the country long ago, when they had the tea industry, you had the first oil well there, you had a small refinery there which is still operating. It's the oldest refinery. I remember 10 years or 15 years ago I went for the 100 years of that refinery. So this place has all the potential.
Mm-hmm.
According to many geologists and oil industry people, it has got a lot of gas and oil. Yet it's been neglected. Actually, many years ago, when I used to travel by train from here to the Northeast, it was, in terms of development, a downhill from Delhi. You would get into Uttar Pradesh, which was lower, then you'd get into Bihar, even lower, then the North Bengal, and then into Assam, and then if you went deeper and deeper, it was a complete downhill. And therefore, that region, the people have a sense of alienation, that they are being left behind from the mainstream. Some of them express it by trying to come and study in Delhi and other parts. Some express it by turning militant. They get misled. So when you have these kind of projects and more communication and more infrastructure coming, it does two important things. One, it boosts the confidence of the people, which will end this alienation, which will integrate them further. Second, it also boosts the confidence of any company or corporate house which may want to invest. If it sees that, okay, the government is serious about infrastructure there, the state government itself has been inviting industrialists, they've been holding conferences to invest in the state.
Mm-hmm.
Along with that, speedy development of infrastructure. There's absolutely no reason this bridge should not have been built for 10, 15 years whenever it was first proposed.
Mm-hmm.
And the third very important aspect of this infrastructure like this is strategic. We're talking of a state where China has been mischievous, and I think we need this kind of connectivity, and this bridge, I think, has been built with a very strong foundation and strong material that it can take heavy duty tank movement and defense equipment movement. So on the whole, it's a very, very positive step.
Okay.
But things should not stop here. You need more development there, more connectivity, and more efforts to make those people feel that you're part of the mainstream.
Okay, more push needs to be given. Let's bring in Mr. Shankar Agarwal here, former Secretary of Ministry of Urban Development. Mr. Agarwal, if you look at from the infrastructure point of view, and that, you know, is connectivity the only part of it? Because there are other projects also which are being given as much importance. You know, for example, the sports university also being set up there. And per se, there are other, you know, infrastructure projects also in several parts of the northeastern region.
Yeah, you see, if we really want to bring happiness to people, it is very necessary that we bring peace and prosperity to that society. And how do you bring peace and prosperity? The only way is that the people should feel connected and integrated. And how do they get integrated and connected? It's only the physical connectivity first, that means the road, rail connectivity, air connectivity, and the internet connectivity. Mm-hmm. And this inauguration of the bridge, which is the longest, almost 5 kilometer long rail-cum-road bridge, will certainly improve the road connectivity as well as the rail connectivity with our distant state. And secondly, as he said, my previous speaker, that is from the strategic point of view also it is very important, because if you want to have peace, it is very necessary that these border areas are secured. Mm-hmm. And this will again help a lot in taking care of the strategic concerns.
Okay.
Coming to the local population and the local infrastructure, people keep moving, people keep migrating from one place to another place in search of employment opportunities and in search of better quality of life. And that's why people are migrating from smaller towns to bigger towns and from rural areas to urban areas. And under this, when we create better infrastructure, physical infrastructure, cultural infrastructure, social infrastructure, that means better schools, better hospitals, better sports facilities, better universities, certainly people feel much better, they feel happier, and they will be able to contribute to the nation building. They feel connected to the rest of the nation. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that under the leadership of the new government, lot of new development is taking place in urban areas and in the smart city and in under the other project of urban development, which is Hriday and Amrit. Lot of our cities are getting good quality citizen-centric infrastructure.
Okay.
I'm sure with all these development, people from Arunachal, people from Assam will feel connected and they'll feel at home and they'll feel that they are part of this entire nation. Okay. And there's no difference between the people of Arunachal Pradesh or the people of Assam and that of, say, North Indian states or the southern states. Okay. Of this country.
So it'll bring a sense of belonging. That's what Mr. Agarwal seems to be pointing out. Mr. Diwan, if we look at the commerce aspect as well, something which was being talked about by Mr. Watts as well, the Act East policy has the commerce being a very, very important pillar of that, you know, boosting trade. But then, as it is always said, that all these three C's are pretty well interconnected. Commerce can only flourish if there is connectivity and communication as well. So how are we moving ahead as far as the commerce part of that three C is concerned?
See, the commerce part, if you look at it again, I'll come back to connectivity. I'll give you one example. We are donor ministry is financing this project, the rail project from Agartala to Akhora, in Bangladesh. Akhora is in Bangladesh. That will further connect to different ports of Bangladesh, which will have sea access to Tripura and parts of Assam, which is closer there, or parts of Meghalaya and also Mizoram. So once this railway line gets into sort of, you know, action, once the rail starts more working there, this will boost the trade, cargo and movement of people, you know. So this will definitely one step. And if you look at the other side, I'll give you one example. We are working on the trilateral international highway, which starts from Guwahati, goes to Nagaland, then goes to Manipur. From there it enters Myanmar. From Myanmar it enters Thailand. Then you have the entire Southeast Asia available to you. But at the same time, once this trilateral highway opens up, you have to have your own products to sell. So keeping that in mind, a lot of projects have been set up, like you mentioned bamboo mission project. Because entire Southeast Asia, bamboo has a great market. Bamboo byproducts, bamboo, pressed bamboo sheets.
And there's a lot of allocation in the Northeast Industrial Development Scheme as well.
For that. And another thing which we are looking at is the handicrafts from Northeast. And another important sector which we have just started, is going to start its production soon. It's a center has been established in Mizoram. It is a food processing center for citrus fruits. It is one of its kind in the country. It is being set up with the Israeli help.
Okay.
Technical.
In the same sense, Sikkim is the first complete organic state.
Organic,
target has already been achieved. Mr. Prasad, you know, one more aspect as far as when we talk about this entire gamut of things is the tourism potential of the Northeast, and that also seemingly will get a lot of push once this entire connectivity and communication targets are achieved for this particular region.
Prime Minister's policy, that is activist policy. I must say that what has happened under this policy, that new ideas are coming up. And say, for example, you have fruits, you have orchids, flowers, you have silk, traditional silk, you have handicrafts, as has been mentioned. That great variety of things happening in the Northeast, and the youth are coming up. The youth of Northeast are showing a lot of promise, which is educational infrastructure and all that. And their acceptability not only in different parts of India, but also in different parts of Southeast Asia will rise. So this is the time for us to think big and plan big and implement faster. Now there you have a great advantage which has not been mentioned, and that will facilitate both commerce and trade and also development. That is, you know what has happened, that every ministry has to keep a portion for the development of the Northeast. And if the money is not spent, it does not lapse. It goes into non-lapsable pool of central resources called NLPCR.
Okay.
So you have huge money there. When I was governor of Sikkim, I tried to get it for building the new capital for Sikkim. Because the capital is here, but when you have the airport, then the whole thing has to be linked. A new township has to come. You have enormous possibilities of development and also connectivity.
And utilization of that fund which you spoke about.
Yes, and it is there. It is there, I know the honorable MPs know. And what has happened, which is not stated, democracy has taken deep roots in the Northeast. And that is a great thing. So we have a message of peace, we have a message of harmony, we have a message of democracy.
And what needs to be done now is to a push to be given.
Let's
bring in Mr. Agarwal. Mr. Agarwal, as Mr. Balmiki Prasad Singh is pointing out, that the focus now should be on implementation of projects. And in terms of funds, there seems to be no crunch here.
Absolutely. There is no doubt that the money is not the problem. Problem is basically how to expedite implementation in the most efficient and the transparent manner. And for that also, connectivity plays a very important role, because with good quality connectivity, people can go from place A to place B. People can travel from, say, Delhi to Arunachal Pradesh in the shortest possible time. And secondly, with these kinds of communication, with these kinds of connectivity, it gives boost to the commerce, because in today's globalized economy, which is a connected economy, you will be able to sell your goods and services only when you are competitive in terms of prices and in terms of quality. So if you are going to take a long journey or a long travel time to transport your goods from place A to place B, naturally you will be non-competitive.
Okay.
So with this kind of an infrastructure, it becomes easier, and people and entrepreneurs in these northeastern states would be in a position to compete with entrepreneurs of, say, northern India or southern India, or even with the European and America.
Okay. Okay. Mr. Butts, looking at, you know, all of this, and also if you add on the other aspect of it, you know, this is the tech era and the digital vision for the Northeast as well, which has been launched for, with a target of 2022. So all these things put in place, how do you see the road ahead as far as Northeastern region is concerned, with such a big push for the connectivity, communication and commerce, as Mr. Diwan was also pointing out?
I think a very strong foundation has been laid for, you know, actual economic, emotional and infrastructural integration with the mainland. So there's phenomenal scope of, you know, rapid progress in that area. And one more point which you touched upon with the previous question was tourism. You know, this is perhaps the only pristine part of India left. You know, if you look at hill stations in the north, they're completely saturated. If you see the monuments, they're taken over by touts and all kinds of things. Northeast still has some absolutely stunningly beautiful places.
Unexplored places.
Unexplored, and, you know, even if you compare, say, a wildlife resort in Northeast or some in North India, you have actual jungles where, you know, they're not surrounded by resorts. So, you know, this is a new area that will open up for the mainstream people. And with this kind of infrastructure, and the fact that, you know, there was a time when if there was a news from the Northeast, you know, Indian newspaper, in a North Indian newspaper, it was probably about somebody wanting to separate, somebody having killed somebody, a clash between the army and some outfit, or some surrendered outfit becoming militant again. That was the only news flow, the only exposure to Northeast to the mainland. Now, repeatedly, we are hearing these kind of projects, and we are not hearing, you know, major bans and all that kind of
law and order issues.
Mm-hmm. So this is a major, you know, a necessary step for development, because, you know, money doesn't flow where there's tension. I mean, it's very clear. People who invest like to go to a peaceful place,
okay,
where things are secure, their life and property is secure, and where there is infrastructure. I think the road ahead now is to build on this and not be satisfied that, okay, we built this bridge, so we've done something for the region. There's still a long way to go. You know, you're dealing with sensitive and relatively innocent people. You know, I mean, most people in Northeast I've interacted with, you know, they're not the crooked kind of people, mm-hmm, but they do tend to be sensitive. So the idea is to give them a sense of fraternity, belonging, and build on that, because, you know, in many senses, it's a virgin area in terms of development. And there's phenomenal scope. You know, the fellow panelist mentioned some agricultural, mm-hmm, produce. You know, if you start exporting bamboo from there, or even other products like ginger, I think Mizoram has a lot of it.
Sikkim. Turmeric.
So there is a lot of
Sikkim
potential.
Can attract so much Buddhist tourism. Sikkim can attract. It's a gold mine, you know.
Okay. Yeah. So clearly, as our panelists have pointed out in the last half an hour, that there is a lot of potential as far as Northeastern region is concerned. And the steps which have been taken to go ahead and bridge the divide, not only do it in terms of providing connectivity and bridging the divide in terms of distance, but also in terms of bringing people together and giving a sense of belonging to the people of that region. So it looks like that a strong foundation has been laid, but as our panelists have pointed out, that we will have to build on this from here onwards and ensure that the development of this region takes shape at a faster pace. We'll come back again tomorrow with a different topic, different set of guests. Till then, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.